So this is the third module in our series on seizures and epilepsy. And up until this point, we've explored the basis of the EEG. We've come to understand what's going on inside the brain at the neuronal network when a seizure occurs, as well as some of the causes of epilepsy. And now we're set to talk about the classification of seizures. This is a really important topic because understanding the different types of seizures is critical to being able to determine what the cause of epilepsy might be in a given patient and also in the design of the treatment plan for the patient. So I actually only have one slide for this topic, but we're going to walk through it carefully. So this is to present the classification of seizures. In order to understand this, I want you to do a thought experiment with me. Let's imagine that we had the ability to actually create a seizure focus. So if you recall from the prior module, we know that when a seizure occurs, there is this hyperexcitability and hypersynchronization of a large group of neurons. So let's imagine that we had a device that could actually create this hypersynchronization and hyperexcitability in one particular part of the brain. I'll make believe that I have one in my hand. It's just a little device, and we'll place it on one side of the brain. Right here, actually, I'm placing it over my motor strip, this part of the cortex. And we turn the device on, and it creates this seizure focus, this hyperexcitability and hypersynchronization over the motor cortex. What would be the manifestation of the seizure? What would be the clinical manifestation of the seizure? Well, it would probably be a change in behavior in the contralateral part of the body. And if this is over the, say, the hand or arm homunculus creating a seizure, you would have abnormal activity or motor movement in the contralateral hand and arm. And that, in fact, is an example of what we call a focal seizure. So here in the upper left, you see a seizure focus being created in the cortical region on this side of the brain. And if it's focal, and it's in the motor area, then we would call that a focal, simple motor seizure. We call it simple because there's no loss of consciousness. If the seizure is only over the motor strip, there's no reason why the patient would have an impairment of their awareness or interaction with the world around them. And it's simply a motor type seizure. All right, well, let's continue the experiment. Let's move this seizure-inducing device a little bit farther back into the parietal lobe. What would be the manifestation? What would be the clinical manifestation of a focal seizure in the parietal lobe? It's focal, it's simple, there's not going to be any loss of consciousness, and it would be sensory. So when the seizure occurs, the patient might actually complain of or notice some abnormality of sensation in their hand or their arm. There are other examples of focal simple seizures. For example, the autonomic components of the nervous system can be involved. This is relatively unusual compared to the first two. But again, because it's occurring in a focus, there's no impairment of consciousness, we call these focal simple seizures. Now let's continue the thought experiment and actually move the seizure-inducing device to a different location. What about placing it in the temporal lobe? Or along the left temporal lobe? What would be the clinical manifestations of causing a seizure in that region? Now, if you think about the structures that exist there, one thing that might be affected is memory, because the hippocampal formation exists in the temporal lobe and is required for normal memory processing. Another impact might be on the amygdala and emotional processing. And finally, certainly if it's on the left side in most patients, a seizure on the left side would affect language. So the patient actually may experience an aphasia. Now, if you combine all these together, memory impairment, changes in emotional processing, inability to use language, it's not surprising that a focal seizure in the temporal lobe would be an example of what we call a complex seizure. That is, there's impaired consciousness or a reduction or loss of ability to react normally to the outside world. There are a number of different types of focal complex seizures. One example, of course, is in the temporal lobe. But if you imagine placing the seizure in the frontal lobe, where higher cortical processing is taking place, you can also see why the clinical manifestations might include things like confusion, again, a difficulty understanding what's going on in the world outside. So these are a couple of examples of what we call focal complex seizures. Now, the second major category of seizures in this classification is referred to as generalized seizures. In this case, rather than there being one single focus that gives rise to a seizure, you know, in different parts of the brain, the seizure occurs over both hemispheres, over the entire brain, essentially all at once. Now, it used to be thought that this sort of instantly occurred over the entire brain, but we now realize that in patients with generalized seizures, it appears that the overall brain is in this hyperexcitable state. One part initially gets engaged, but then it rapidly spreads to both sides of the brain. So again, we refer to these as generalized seizures. And there are a number of different subtypes. One very important type is called absence seizures or petit-mal seizures. These tend to occur in children, school-age children, and they're characterized by very brief losses of consciousness. The person, the child is usually able to maintain their posture, but they suddenly look as though they're daydreaming. There may be some small fluttering of the eyelids or some little tiny motor movements of the hands, but they're usually very brief. In typical cases, there may be dozens, if not hundreds of these a day. And the EEG signature that characterizes absence seizures is the so-called 3-per-second spike in wave activity, which you can actually measure across all parts of the, essentially all parts of the brain at the same time. And if you go back to the previous two modules and take a look at the EEG that I showed you that represented a seizure being recorded by the EEG, and look carefully, you'll actually see that that spiking activity was part of a 3-per-second spike in wave, and that EEG was actually capturing an absence seizure in a child. The second major subcategory, and actually the most common type of seizures overall, are tonic-clonic or tonic-clonic seizures. Again, these are seizures that engage both hemispheres all at once. There's very high frequency, high voltage activity, and again, depending on the seizure type, there may be mostly a tonic activity, which would be, for example, extension of the limbs held over many seconds, or clonic-like activity, which is activation and inhibition, or a combination of the two. The most common would be beginning with tonic extension or flexion of the extremities, and then this clonic-type activity. There are also atonic seizures. In this case, there's a sudden loss of the tone, and these are some of the most dangerous types of seizures because patients will suddenly lose consciousness and completely collapse to the ground, which of course can be the cause of some very significant physical injury. And then there are myoclonic seizures. These are very sudden, almost lightning-like jerks of activity. You probably have observed this, perhaps in someone who's falling asleep. This is actually normal if it occurs rarely and only during those occasions. But as someone's falling asleep, they may suddenly have a sudden jerk like that. That would be an example of a myoclonic jerk. But there are certain epilepsy syndromes in which frequent events of myoclonus are part of a larger epilepsy syndrome. Now, the third category, the final category in the classification of seizures, is when the seizure occurs focally, but it gradually spreads to the point where it leads to a generalized seizure. And these are referred to as focal seizures with secondary generalization. Now, this third category is really important. I want you to remember this. I'm going to emphasize this with a flashing yellow light. And the reason is that a focal seizure with secondary generalization can be distinguished from a generalized seizure only by recognizing what the onset of the seizure was like. Now, sometimes this can be observed. For example, if a patient is observed to begin having focal movements of the arm or the face that over the next number of seconds spreads and they have a generalized seizure, that would lead you to believe that, in fact, the seizure has an identifiable focus. On the other hand, if the patient suddenly collapses without any warning that they can describe later or any focal type of clinical activity, they may have a generalized seizure. The reason it's so important to distinguish the two is that the workup of a patient who might have a focal seizure is different than a generalized seizure. In other words, patients who have a focal seizure or focal with secondary generalization may have an identifiable underlying brain lesion that needs to be treated directly in order for them to become free of seizures. Whereas patients with generalized seizures may not have such a focus that would be amenable to treatment. Now, we've now gone through the classification of seizures, and in the next module, we'll explore the management of patients with seizures and epilepsy.
All right, hold for just a second.